Good evening, everybody. Those who got it before, good evening again. And those who just came in and joined in online, good evening. All right. We started I call it a neat little series last week that I believe will benefit our Christian life, entitled The Christian Commandments. The Christian Commandments, the do's and don'ts of Christianity. And so, even in preparing it for me, as I look at some of these instructions for life, for Christian life, I said to myself, my word, this is just great reminder, great instructions. It's all there in scriptures for us to see, you know, but sometimes when again you just make a list and you compile things, it just pops out at you. So for me, it has already been just ministering to my heart, and I trust that it will do the same for you. I'm going to pray one more time and ask God to just minister to our hearts, the Holy Spirit, to just use these Christian commandments from scripture to help our lives. So Father, we come before you and we come again to hear from you, to learn from your word, and some of it, most of it will be reminder, but oh, how we need the reminding, because it is difficult at times to simply put, remember everything we are to do. And you have instructed us how to live this Christian life, and we need to be able to have it cemented in our hearts and then fashion our lives. So bless the time now as we continue to look at these things. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The Christian commandments, the do's and don'ts of Christianity. We looked at maybe about seven of them, and I won't spend time to explain. We will just reiterate by listing. Last time we were here, we said, one, we must abstain from all appearances of evil. Remember, each slide has it, the verses that represent it. Next thing we said is that we must abstain from fleshly lusts. Next thing we said is that we must avoid troublemakers. We must next avoid profane and vain babblings. And then we said that we must avoid foolish questions and contentions. And that's where we stopped. All right. So next, we're going to be looking at the B's. We must be quick to reconcile. Quick to reconcile. Again, if we pay attention to these instructions compiled from scripture, it is a guarantee that our lives will be richer. Our walk will be obedient. You know, our whole lives will be transformed. Interestingly, that's one of the words we'll look at in a while too. So, be quick to reconcile. Matthew 5, 23 to 24, they say, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother hath aught against thee, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way. First be reconciled to thy brother, and then come and offer thy gift. Be quick to reconcile. In fact, if you know the next verse, verse 25 says, agree with your adversary, your enemy, your opposer quickly. Verse 25 says that, you know, as you are going to court with the person. The person has an offense and then going to take it to court. He said, agree with your adversary quickly while you're in the way, so that you might come to some agreement, lest the person take you to the judge and the police come for you and take you to prison. The idea is that when we have conflicts and disagreements, we must seek to reconcile them quickly. Don't let your differences just keep dragging out your offenses, and you know, the idea is that especially if we are the ones that have been offensive to somebody, but even if somebody has offended us, we know what Matthew 18 also says, that if you are in the wrong or they are in the wrong, it doesn't matter, be quick to reconcile. And I just want to remind us that this is in scripture, because sometimes I've seen, you know, church brothers and sisters, family members, friends, co-workers, you name it, community personnel, all Christians, and how we have handled, you know, our offenses. There are too many Christians who have continued to remain offended. Remain offended. I am hurt by what you did. I'm hurt by what this person did. Did you talk to the person? No. We have to stick with this one for a moment, you know. We need to grow up. We need to be mature. We need to realize that the idea of running to reconcile is the God's idea of that, to run to reconcile and be quick about it, is so that we can get on with the business of the Lord, get on with the fellowship of the church and so forth, get on with the fellowship of your family members. It is not for us to be dragging out things and holding out and playing hard end. It's not healthy. So may we understand what relationships should look like. Simple stuff, you know, but profound stuff. Be quick to reconcile. Is there anybody you think you need to run to tonight or call up tonight or by a morning if they're asleep by the time you reach home? Listen, this is what you call one of the, one of the pillars of reconciliation, one of the pillars of relation, dealing with resolving conflicts. Be quick to reconcile. I want to encourage anybody that's online, anybody that's in-house, if you name the name of Christ, you call yourself a Christ follower, a believer, a Christian, and if you have offended somebody or somebody has offended you, be quick to reconcile. Deal with it. It is for your own benefit, the benefit of the family, benefit of the friendship, benefit of the church, benefit of the workplace, benefit of the community. Be quick to reconcile. Amen? Amen. Next one, brother. Next one. And if you have questions, comments, you can just raise your hand as you go along, because a lot of it is just simply instructional. Next one. This is very easy. Nothing much needs to be said about it. We said to be quick to reconcile. Next thing, be thankful. Be thankful. Colossians 3 verse 15 says, "And let the peace of God rule in your hearts, to the which also you are called in one body, and be ye thankful." Have a grateful heart, a thankful heart, thanking God for everything. Thank him for the good. Thank him for the bad he has allowed in your life. Be grateful. Sometimes there are some people who they spend time trying to, you know, dwell on the negative, dwell on the things that went wrong. You know, there are some people, what went wrong today? They're auditing their day and it's nighttime and they say, what went wrong today? Christ wants us to be able to look at what went right. God wants us to have a thankful heart. And if you notice what he uses to guide that thankful heart, peace. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. A peaceful person is a thankful person. If you're not at peace, you're not grateful enough. If you're not at peace, you're not thankful. If you're miserable, you're ungrateful. Usually miserable people and ungrateful people come together in terms of these two things. Be thankful. Where you get that kind of gratitude, a heart of gratitude from, I remind you, it's right up there. Peace of God. Let that reign, govern your heart, and then you will be a thankful person. Amen? Let's keep going. All right, let's keep going. Next. This one, be patient toward all persons. I don't like it. I don't like it. As I did these, I'm going to tell you why I'm going to like it. Because when I saw it, I know I'm failing at this one. But that's why I like these Christian commandments, because it shows me up, it shows us up. You know, we look at what we are good and we can check off the list, and we look at what we are bad and we go, so, this one is difficult. Why? You say, but some of you might say, Pastor, I thought you were patient. Yes, but you don't realize what I tell you to do. Patient to who? We're not patient with everybody. Yeah, we're not patient with everybody. Patient toward all persons. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 14 says, "Now we exhort you, brethren." And I like how it starts. Before it tells you to be patient with everybody, it wants you to understand that patient people must not be doormats. Patient people must not be walkovers. And patient people must not stay quiet. Because we sometimes think that patience is doormat and walkover, you know, say nothing, you know. No, notice what it said before it gets to being patient. You know, But you do it with all patience and meekness. But he says, warn them that are unruly. Sometimes we think that there are some people who are good at being patient. Yeah, you know those kind of people. They're patient toward everybody, but them can't warn the unruly. Then there's no balance. What it is saying is that if there's something wrong, an unruly person is an insubordinate person, a stubborn, rebellious person. And he says, warn them. And then it says, comfort the feeble-minded, those who are, their minds, they're troubled in mind, weaker in mind. You know, they're not so strong in their thinking. It says, comfort them. So you warn the unruly, comfort the feeble-minded. Then it says, support the weak, those who are just faint-hearted, those who are just, they're just easily discouraged. It says, support them. But then in doing so, be patient toward all persons. It's going to take patience to support the weak. It's going to take patience to comfort the feeble-minded. And it's going to take patience to warn the unruly. Because it's the idea that you don't give up on people. Do what you need to do. Do what is right. But be patient toward all men. And that one was a tough pill, big pill to swallow. I said to myself, Lord, give me more patience. And as we go through these Christian commandments, that's what we need to be doing. Ask the Holy Spirit to do a spiritual audit. Lord, is this the one that I need to work on, improve on? You know, if you see one that you're doing well in, you thank the Lord. You be grateful. You say, thank you, Lord. I'm managing that one nicely. But when you come to one that you're convicted about, that you know you're just totally failing, let's just humble ourselves before God and say, Lord, increase my patience, not just your faith, but increase my patience. Amen? That's why I tell you that this is going to be good for our Christian life, you know, if you apply it. So be patient toward all persons. Let's keep going if no questions. I didn't like this one either. Not only must we be patient toward all persons, but we must be patient in tribulation. Romans 12 verse 12 says, rejoicing in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. That one is also difficult because some tribulations, some trials that we go through are longer than others. You know, when it becomes even harder to be patient in a tribulation, when your trial is longer than your church brother one or longer than your church sister one, remember just start the things them because I never normally hold back anyway. You ever look at some people's life and them trials just always seem short? In other words, it's like them get a quick break with God almost every time. Them go through stuff, you know, but it's like, I just a little 1 month thing or a 1 week thing. And for them life, if you look upon it, always seem like them just, you know, for them trial just done quick. While you have got through like almost 7 years of tribulation, 10 years or 20 years, and you say, Lord, this is why you're going to have to ask God to give you more grace. Because if you watch other people, you go out, get vexed with God and say, why you couldn't? So we have to be patient in tribulation because tribulations at times are going to be longer than we expect, longer than we can at times manage, even though we can manage it. I keep reminding people about Job. Job is a perfect example of that, an imperfect example of the same thing too. He started well, but a lot of the times we don't preach chapter 4, you know, to chapter 38, 39. He did well for a while, but after a while, Job was cursing the very day he born. Job was saying, I wish me the dead. God, just kill me, no man. He wasn't handling it well after a while, and I remember telling you why. Let me remind you why. Because after a while, it got to him. Sometimes when we read Job chapter 1 and 2, we don't remember that after 1 and 2 comes 3. And then I don't know how long it is, but Job, it's not like he overcame. It's not like a 7-day wonder. It could have lasted for months. I don't know how long, but it's not like a 1 week wonder. So he was doing well, let's say for a month or a week. I don't know how long it is. And though he slay me, yet will I trust him. But after a while, when the sores start And not start, them did already start, but they continued. And it's like, they're still here? And your wife, I said, me not sleeping at the same bed with you. And remember that he lost his children. Grief is still there. Still fresh. Because even if it's 8 months down the line, grief is still fresh. Think about some of you, us who have lost our loved ones. Eh? 3 years, 4 years gone, and you're still remembering it. So imagine Job, even if it were months, the idea is that he was enduring a lot, and after a while it got to him. Even Job needed patience because it was getting to him. So, my friends, I just want to encourage you. Trials at times will almost seem everlasting. But ask God for more patience. Because God is actually instructing us to be patient in our tribulation. Notice what he says, rejoice in hope. You know, it's have a hopeful mindset that, listen, this is going to be over one day. Rejoice in the hope that you have. And so that will help you to be patient in tribulation. And then you are going to continue instant in prayer. You don't stop praying. There are going to be times, friends, I'm just going to just be honest with you. There are going to be times when some of you, some of us will feel, you know, will have a valley moment. You are doing well for 8 months and then on the 9th month, you're just dropping out the valley. You just feel like, say, you can't even pick up yourself to come church. Am I talking the things them? And this happens to strong believers, you know. Who would have, you would have said that? No, man. Before you know it, you'll be surprised sometimes how many Christians are discouraged. You know, you don't see them and you wonder what is going on when you reach out to them. They're not even telling the truth either. Can I tell you that sometimes some of them shame too? I'm just going to be honest. Sometimes some of them are ashamed because they would have been what you call stalwarts of the faith, but something, a trial is getting them down and they don't even want to admit it to you. You can't hear the coming to your sister Christine. You can't hear the facade at times. Them tell you all kind of excuses, but the real thing is that they are depressed or discouraged, but them no want to admit it because them are Christian long time and they never expect, say, you're not expecting them to feel that way. But remember, my friends, be patient and just hope in God. Yes, Christine.
Yes, sometimes it's not just because they feel embarrassed or afraid. Sometimes it's just how people will react to what they say.
Yeah.
Because people see them as strong Christians. Yeah. And if they express to someone that they're struggling, that person might exclaim, you know?
Yeah.
So they
yeah.
feel away. So they keep it to themselves.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's
yeah.
that.
Yeah. Yeah. So I want to encourage anybody who is here or listening online that if you cannot find anybody to talk to, or if you're not getting any kind of encouraging words from anybody, you must still remember that there's a God who is right beside you, who loves you. If you cannot find the strength to pick up yourself off the ground, remember that there's a God who is on the ground with you, helping you up. Just work with him, because he's also saying, listen, I am giving you hope, rejoicing it, and be patient in tribulation. It may be long, but not forever. Because the same God who is with you is the same God who is also still telling you not to give up. Be patient in your tribulation. Stop watching the time. Stop watching the clock. Stop watching the calendar. Lord, I 7 years now, you know, I'm in a married yet. You know, I 10 years now, I'm in a find another man or another wife. Lord, you know, Lord, at 12 years, I'm going to get one house. You know, the different things that we would count and say, I saw so long now, I'm going to get this. This not happen yet. Be patient in your tribulation. All right? And some of the stuff we mentioned as example are not even as bad as some of the stuff that people go through. Tribulation, hardships, suffering. They just don't, they can't provide. The Spirit just some must tell this to somebody who is listening. Sometimes the tribulation will be that you just can't make ends meet, you know. Every month are the same thing. It's like the money marga. And you are throw your tithes, you know. You say, am I talking to somebody tonight? And I like say you're not throw your tithes, you know. Because, some of them just start the things them. Yeah, some people then throw them tithes on them because the idea is that you throw your tithes, you're not skim it off, you're giggard, but yet still you're not see the returns at time. Am I talking some things?
You now see the returns and you say to yourself, say, Lord, oh, it's so hard. And you have got through that for months and years. He says, be patient in it. In other words, it's not going to be that way forever. Your breakthrough will come, but breakthroughs are not all timed the same way. The corner is longer for some. It's the Jamaican corner we are talking about. Just on the corner, you know the just on the corner that never comes. It's the Jamaican corner we're talking. It's just your breakthrough just on the corner, but on the long corner and on the short corner. But be patient. Be patient. It's going to happen. Victory is going to happen, my friend. So don't give up. Be patient in tribulation. Amen? Amen. Amen. We're not meant to live this life like this all the time. Next one, Pastor Evans. This one is something is a verse we all know. Be ready to give an answer. 1 Peter 3 verse 15 says, but sanctify the Lord God in your hearts and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope that is in you with meekness and fear. Now, I delved into this verse a little more, because usually it is one of those verses where you set yourself, say, you know, we almost just pull out this one phrase, you know, be ready to give an answer to every man. Be ready to give an answer to every man. And we forget about the phrases before and that surround it, and after as well. Eh? All right. So I want you to understand something here. I'm going to pop up something and let you see what this verse is really meaning. It says, sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. That idea of sanctify the Lord God in your heart means to consecrate Christ in your heart. It means to revere Christ as Lord in your life. You know, the Lord God must be sanctified. Give him honor in your hearts as Lord. As Lord. And then it says, and be ready always to give an answer to every man, every woman, every person that asketh you a reason concerning the hope that is in you. We'll catch the last phrase in a moment. But he wants, first of all, us to hallow God, revere God as the King of our lives. And then it says, be ready to give an answer to anybody that asks you the hope that is in you, a reason. Be ready to defend it. But sometimes I think that we kind of miss the true meaning of this verse, you know. We kind of use it as an apologetic verse, which is not wrong either, you know. But I think we miss the other side of it. The idea is that be ready to defend the faith, yes, but I think there is a more profound meaning that we miss. The idea that if somebody looks at you and you seem to be weathering the storm well, and they say to you, for example, why are you always so happy? Somebody asking you for the reason why you're so happy, then you tell them why. Or somebody says to you, you know, I'm on problem. One of the authors, the commentator, said it this way, that sometimes some of these persons may even ask you, not necessarily in a nice way, but in almost in a mocking way. Hey, where's your God now? You know, y'all got your struggles. Where's your God now? The idea is that the reason for the hope, why do you believe in Christ? That's a question that people ask. Why do you believe in Christ? How you know say y'all go heaven? It says, be ready to give them the reason for the hope that you have. You hope in Jesus. You hope in Christ that he saves you. You hope in Christ that you're going to heaven. Give them a reason for it. Give them an answer for it. But then the latter part of the verse is what I usually don't pay much attention to. I'm going to be honest with you. And that's when the teaching moment came and said, look at how we must answer them. It says, with meekness and fear. Let me read it from another version. Give honor to Christ in your hearts as your Lord, and be ready at any time when you are questioned about the hope which is in you to give an answer in the fear of the Lord and without pride. Wow. Without pride. Do it meekly. So let me give an example in case you're not getting this. Here's what not to do. If somebody asks you, how is it that you always seem like you're so happy, sir? Well, that's because I'm blessed and you're not. You understand me now? Blessed and highly favored, and you're not. Because it says, when you answer them, do it so meekly, with humility. Because you have some people, listen, there's a place for us to boast on God, you know. But some of us boast on self. It's almost like you want to make yourself more special than you really are. We are special in Christ, don't get me wrong, you know, but it's almost like you want, the answer you're giving is a showing off, and the person might be turned off by it. It says, when you answer them, do it with humility. And we most of the times, including myself, miss that part. So how do you know you're going to heaven? Because I am saved and you're not. That's not right. The idea is that we must do it with me, cancer, because Jesus Christ saved me by his mercy. I don't even deserve to go to heaven, but he saved me, and I'm going to heaven because of Jesus. Turn it back with fear, reverence in the Lord. The one author commentator said this way, with reverence to God and respect to the person. With reverence to God and respect to the person. Even if they meant it in a jeering way, they ask a question in a jeering way, you answer them with reverence to God and respect to the person, remembering who we are representing when we answer them. Am I making sense? This verse is supposed to kind of come to a whole new, perspective when we put the whole thing together, you know. Because a lot of the times I say we just pull out this one part, you know, be ready to give an answer to everyone. But when people ask you certain things, it's a quick prayer like, God, give me wisdom. You remember this long time story that still comes on certain radio stations about this lady who grew up her son, you know, in the fear and admonition of the Lord. And then when he went to college, he just strayed from God. And when he came back home, you know, she had questions to ask him. You know, why you don't talk about God anymore? And him said, well, I'm not in this God business anymore. I'm not believing in God. And him started to ask her questions. And it's something like that now. So he would say to mama, can you touch God? Can you see God? Can you feel God? And all of her answers were no. And she was already teary-eyed and said, I know where it's going with this. Until you can show me a God I can touch and feel and so forth, then there is no God. She went to bed, and what did the mother do? She was praying and said, Lord, give me an opportunity to defend my faith before my son, who should have had the same faith. And she heard him moaning and groaning, and you know, she went there and she said, son, what is wrong with you? And he said, oh mama, it hurts so bad. I have a toothache and it's moving in my, in jaw. And she said, so son, can you see the toothache? And he said, no mama. Huh? Can you what? What else you say? Can you touch the toothache? No mama, but I know it's there. Right quick there, God spoke to that mother. And she said, when you asked me earlier about can I see God and touch God, my answer was no. But same as though you can affirm that there's a toothache because you feel it, I want you to know that I feel God because he moves in my life all the time. That is what we're talking about, being ready. So we pray to answer people. So Lord, give me wisdom here so that my answer will be something that will edify, that will glorify God, edify the person, enlighten the person, encourage the person, help the person, correct the person, you name it. Amen? So make sure that we're doing that. All right, any questions, comments on that? All right, wonderful. Let's keep going. We can do at least one or two more. Next one, be transformed. And this is self-explanatory as well. But every time I say that, I find more stuff to say about it. Be transformed. You're not just going to be ready to give an answer. You're going to be transformed. Romans 12 verse 2 says, and be not conformed to this world. Don't allow yourself to fit into this worldly system. Don't be conformed to this world. If you're a child of God, do not allow the world to fit you in their mold. But be ye transformed, metamorphosis, changed. By the where? By the what? Not your body, you know. Renew your mind and the rest will follow. By the renewing of your mind that you may prove. This is again another part sometimes we don't even follow through on. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. God expects us to demonstrate change. If we call ourselves children of God, we are to demonstrate change, transformation. And he says that when we are transformed by the renewing of our mind, it will prove itself. You are going to be proving what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So sometimes some people will tell you that they are changed. But if they are changed and they keep doing the same thing over and over again, then change has not taken place. The Bible says change must be proven. Transformation must be seen. You know, it's what I find it ironic. I'm going to make an ironic statement. That the Bible says we must be renewed in our mind. And some people take it too literal. We only change in our mind, but not with action. You get that one there? Let me say it again. The Bible says we must be changed in our mind. Some people change in their mind, but them actions not change. The actions must be proven. The actions must be proven. Change begins in the mind, but the mind must affect your actions. Amen? Prove that which is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. We must change. It is a non-negotiable for Christians. Amen? Wonderful. I love this. I don't know who else is loving it. All right, let's keep going. I won't spend time on this next one because I preached on it one Sunday a couple weeks back. Not only must we be transformed, but we must be steadfast. All right? Therefore, 1 Corinthians 15, 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord. For as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Anybody remembers that message a couple weeks back? What I said steadfast means? I preached on steadfast faith. What does the word steadfast mean? Anybody remember? Anybody want to guess? Anybody supposed to know who afraid say you might say the wrong thing, but go ahead, just say something. No, do not bother shame me. There are people watching online. Yes? Sticking to it. Yeah, put your own terms to it. No, nobody try to find the Greek meaning where Pastor Giuno. And you must know something. Sticking to it. What else? Give me some more meanings. Steadfast. Huh? Firmly grounded. And that's definitely one of the phrases I gave you. Firmly grounded. If you have another version, another word, you will see settled. All right? Even though unmovable and steadfast are two different Greek words, they are similar. Because they can also be used interchangeably. So being steadfast means that you must be grounded, firmly planted. You must be settled. All right? No wishy-washy Christian business. Either you're in or you're out. You're serving God or you're not serving God. No in between. Remember what he said to the church at Laodicea. I will spit you out. I'd rather if you were hot or you're cold. But you can't be on the fence. So be grounded. Be steadfast and stable and sure. Amen? All right, let's keep going. I think we can do a few more. Yeah, man, we're doing good time. We have a whole heap, you know, but we're not going to do all of them one night. All right, next one, Pastor Evans. This one is, I find, very interesting. I'm going to also pop up a few translations to bring it into bear. It says here, be in harmony with each other. Romans 12, verse 16 says, be of the same mind, one toward another. Guys, I think, and I'm just going to be honest with you, there are times even myself miss the message of a verse because we don't read it over and over. It never said we must be of the same mind. It says we must be of the same mind toward each other. Wow. And then it says, mind not high things, but condescend to men of low estate. Be not wise in your own conceits. This is strong stuff, you know. I might just end here tonight, depending on how far. That was what? Romans 12 verse what? 14? 16? I have a Bible program open because I want to be able to show you. If you don't get what the King James is saying, I want to be able to show you what the other versions are saying to bring it out better. And I loved how it read it out. So, guys, listen to what this verse is saying. Be in harmony with one another. Agree with each other. Be of the same mind one toward another. Treat each other the same. So, in other words, Sister Verona over here, I am to treat her and think of her the same way as I think of Sister Porteous over here. And Brother Omar over here, I'm to still think of Brother Omar as I think of Sister Porteous, as I think of Sister Verona. And the whole of us must do the same thing. No curry favor thoughts. Wow. No favorites in our thoughts. You be of the same mind one toward another. So in other words, me love Sister Box the same as me love Sister Tiny. And that's for all of us. Some of us miss that, you know. Here's how another version puts it. Have the same respect for one another. Powerful stuff, you know. I don't think that we knew that, you know. I don't think that we interpreted this verse right, you know, because it's still, I'm going to go down the line of it, but I want us to get the first phrase first when it says, be of the same mind one to one another. Be in harmony with one another. Have the same respect for one another. Minding the same thing toward one another. Have full sympathy with one another. Eh? Wow. Live in harmony with one another. Let the same spirit guide you all. The same spirit of sympathy, the same spirit of empathy. Though, you know, like some people, you feel sorry for this one, but you don't feel sorry for this one. You empathize with this one, but you don't even sympathize with the other. Wow, this is powerful stuff, you know. Huh? And then it goes on to say, mind not high things. Now, what do you think that means? Mind not high things means do not have a high opinion of yourself. Wow. Set not your minds on high affairs. Huh? Do not be haughty. Mind not high things. Huh? Do not give your mind to high things. And then it says, but condescend. And many people don't like that word. It doesn't sound good. But the instructions coming here from the Bible must mean that it can't be a bad thing in this context. So when we don't like condescending, the Bible is saying there is a good condescending here, but condescend to men of low estate. Here's what that means. Be in agreement with common people. Go along with the humble. Associate with the humble folk. Eh? Associate with the humble. Because there are some people, you know, let me tell the things now. There are some Christians, you know, because I don't want to use the word people too general. There are some Christians, you know, them we almost tell you, you know, in my league, you know. And then behave that way, pantafight, you know. There are some Christians, may I tell you, say, if I never God, may I tell you, say, you're the wonder. There are some, them make up their minds, say, they're going to go shake some people, hand hug some people, but never some people. They make up their minds, and they're going to go say hello to that one and not hello to this one. Hi, good morning. The pastor gets the best of everything, by the way. Think me not know? Yeah, may I soak it all up, but you must treat brother so-and-so and sister so-and-so the same way. It says associate with the people, humble people. This is strong, you know. And then it ends by saying, be not wise in your own conceits. You know what that means? Do not give yourselves an air of wisdom. Be not wise in your own eyes. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Do not think too highly of yourself. What a powerful verse. I think that's a good place to end tonight. Because we might need to do a humble prayer. Because we just ate some humble pie. Eh? Be in harmony with each other. That's what that verse means. Think of everybody in the same way. Love everybody the same way. No special love. No special treatment. Everybody must be treated specially. That's what it means. Because I don't want you to think that I'm saying, oh, someone mustn't treat people special. No. If you're going to treat people specially, make sure everybody. And if you know the context, is especially to the household of faith, treat everybody as special. Think of everybody as special. Wow. And I believe that if we understand what these instructions are saying to us as Christians, we will definitely have a better Christian walk, a better Christian church, Christian family, you name it. Relationships will be better. We will be better Christians. Amen? And remember, you know, I tell you, it's a lot of them, you know. So we're just going to just go through this as we go. If it takes us months, we're drinking in all of these instructions. When it would have taken you days and weeks and months to read the entire New Testament, we have compiled what we would call the essential Christian commandments so that we can see them and practice them and be better in our walk. Amen? May I just pause here then? And I think the Spirit is just simply leading me to do this. Let's just have a prayer of confession. A prayer just humbling ourselves before God. It could have, might not have been the one we just talked about. Maybe it's not, maybe you treat everybody the same way, but maybe you're not patient, like I said, not patient everybody. I struggle with that. What era are we struggling in that we realize that, no, God, I'm going to have to do better because the instructions are not coming from Pastor Madden. They're coming from your word. This is how you want us to live. You've given these instructions. And let's just humble ourselves before God and say, Lord, shine your light. Forgive me for my flaws and failures. Forgive me for, you know, for not doing these things. And whatever it is, you call it out. And then we pledge to do better. We pledge to live better. And when we practice living better, our lives and the people around us will be better. Our church will be better. Our families will be better. Our schools will be better. Our community will be better. Amen? So, let's just pray. Go and give you a moment of silence, and then I'll conclude this prayer. Let's just pray. Even those who are online, pause for prayer. Talk to your God. Holy Father, we turn ourselves in. We start with our minds. We start with our thoughts. We ask that you will consecrate our thoughts.
Lord, sometimes we don't easily and readily identify our faults. Sometimes we have been prideful and don't know. Sometimes we have been stubborn and we don't realize. Sometimes we have been ungrateful. Sometimes we have been showing favor to certain people and disfavor to others. Lord, let us go down the line and see. We thank you that there are some areas that we might have been strong in. But Lord, it's about our weaknesses right now. Our weaknesses that may be hindering the growth of a church, the growth of a family, the growth of a relationship, or simply put, the growth of ourselves. Lord, there are some Christians who are simply holding fast, stubborn as a mule. They have been offended or have been offensive, and they are not being quick to reconcile. I don't have to get any survey done to know that this is how some Christian people behave. They struggle with reconciliation and they struggle with forgiveness. But in the name of Jesus, we ask that you will break that attitude, break that stronghold, and help us to humble ourselves. And if we have been offended, if somebody has offended us, help us to be quick to talk about it and agree. If we have offended somebody, help us to be quick to talk about it. Either way, help us to understand if we have wronged somebody, help us to apologize. Or if somebody has wronged us, help us to forgive. Lord, you name it. You show us up and help us to then sort it out. You point it out to us. Holy Spirit, show us ourselves. Show us our weaknesses. Let nobody else show us. When you speak, we listen. And we cannot defend ourselves before you either way too. So just show us up, dear God. And right now, each of us, as you show us up, we pray, dear God, that you will turn these weaknesses into strengths. We pray that you will overturn them. We pray, dear God, that you will turn the tables on them. Dear God, I pray that we will understand that grace is now being dispensed. Holy Spirit, clean us up. Forgive us. We humble ourselves and we say to you that we, Lord, there's so much here that we are going to learn and so much that we have already learned. Help us to understand that, yes, Christianity has many expectations. But you would not have asked us and told us and instructed us to live a certain way if you didn't think it was beneficial to us. So let us not think of it as a burden. Many instructions, but they will be a blessing to us if we follow them. So God, we humble ourselves before you and we ask that you will forgive us. And we pray, dear God, that you will straighten us out, straighten our walk. Thank you for these instructions so far. We look forward to hearing more. The reminders as well as the enlightening moments when we would have simply missed the message of a verse or a statement. And I pray that this will show in our church. Meaning, the growth will show in our church. The improvements will show in our church. The maturity will show in our church. The maturity and growth will show in our lives, in our families, in our relationships. It will show in our workplaces. It will show in our communities. It will show in our homes. It will show in our positions. Everywhere we turn, people should see a difference. So God, make us different. Make us a blessing. In Jesus' name I pray.